Here we have water flowing through a heated pipe. The pipe has some length L, an inner diameter D. We know the temperature of the water entering the pipe is some known value Tn. We're going to assume that the inner surface of the pipe has some known temperature Ts. We're going to assume that Ts is constant along the length of the pipe. We'll define a coordinate axis Z that starts at 0 at the entrance of the pipe. Our objective is to find the temperature as a function of Z. It starts at the inlet temperature, and what we would expect is for it to asymptotically approach the surface temperature of the pipe for large values of Z. The first thing we'll start with is a simulation that shows the temperature both as a function of Z and as a function of the radius. Here I've selected a pipe that has a length of 2 meters and a radius of 5 millimeters. So pay attention to these graphs. Know that these are not to scale. I've dramatically increased the vertical axis on it. The temperature will have an inlet temperature of 0 degrees C and a surface temperature of 100 degrees C. And I've also included a temperature of 1 degree C, which could represent the thermal boundary. Layer. So in the simulation, the thing to look at is the cross-sectional area as a function of Z. Note that the temperature is always higher at the walls of the pipe and diffuses inward, warming the fluid towards the center of it. However, what we're after is just the average temperature as a function of Z. I'm showing the simulation here to give you an idea of what's actually going on, but keep in mind we're just looking for an average temperature as a function of that cross-section. If you'd like to reproduce any of these simulations, I'm giving you all the values that went into it, but later on, ultimately what we're going to need for the average temperature is the radius, the length, the inlet temperature, the surface temperature of the pipe, the mass flow rate of the water, the heat capacity, and the average heat transfer coefficient along the length of the pipe. And that average heat transfer coefficient I got from a correlation. The simulation starts with an entrance temperature of 0 degrees C and a surface temperature of 100 degrees C. As we move down the axis of the pipe, you could see the heat diffusing towards the central axis. And that white region, which we represent the boundary layer of 1 degree C, begins to converge, and eventually, somewhere maybe down a meter of the pipe, we'd see the boundary layers converging to the center of the pipe. And at this point, as we move from left to right, the temperature continues to increase along the length of the pipe. And at any particular location, we want to find the temperature that's averaged across the radius of that cross-section. To go about doing this, we're going to write an energy balance around a differential slice of our pipe. And I should mention that it's not actually the pipe that we're going to do a differential balance on, it's the water within that differential slice. So I'm going to remove the pipe walls itself just to avoid confusion. We're just going to look at the water. Within this control volume, we've got a mass flow rate of water carrying thermal energy in at a location of Z. The width of our control volume, we'll say, is dZ, and the water is carrying thermal energy out of the pipe at location Z plus dZ. Heat is also being added to the exterior of our control volume, and we'll call that our surface flux multiplied by the area around the perimeter of our control volume. So when we write this out, we have the two forms of energy entering the control volume, and that's going to equal the rate at which energy leaves the control volume. If we rearrange our equation and take the limit as dz approaches zero, we're left with this differential equation. Note that we're using a circular geometry, so the outer perimeter is pi times the diameter, but sometimes you'll see this defined as PER, a more generalized parameter like a square tube. By the definition of convective heat transfer into the water, the flux is equal to the average heat transfer coefficient multiplied by the driving force, which is the surface temperature minus the average temperature at z. Making the substitutions, we now have a differential equation that we can integrate to find the temperature as a function of z. Once we separate this equation, we'll integrate this from 0 to some arbitrary value of z. We'll integrate the temperature from the inlet temperature to some temperature t. Performing the integration, we're left with a negative natural log of this ratio. And when we rearrange that, we find this exponential relationship between the temperature and the position z. Let's double check the units within the exponential. We know that they have to be dimensionless. The heat transfer coefficient has dimensions of watts per meter squared Kelvin. The perimeter has dimensions of length. Z has dimensions of length. The heat capacity, 1 over the heat capacity, is kilogram Kelvin per joule. And the 1 over the mass flow rate is seconds per kilogram. And canceling out the units, we're left with a joule per second is equal to a watt, and that cancels out with the watt in the numerator. So this is dimensionless, we're good on the units. This is a graph of that equation for the parameters that I've selected for this problem. We see the temperature increases from 0 degrees C at the entrance up to close to 50 degrees C by the time we've reached the length of 2 meters. If we were to increase the length of the pipe from 2 meters up to 15 meters, we can more readily observe the asymptotic approach of the average temperature up to 100 degrees C.